Julian, I'm always blown away by the sheer scale of these Elizabeth Line stations. As an architect, how do you go about creating such a beautiful edifice?
Well, we first start by looking at the nature of the service that's going to be provided and the railway systems that are necessary to support that service, and that therefore drives the number of people that have to be accommodated. And into that, there's a whole series of functionality portions of the design that drop out. So the numbers of people in the train service will drive the size of the platforms and the sizes of the spaces through the stations. It will also drive the level of equipment that's needed, such as fans, to support the running of the rail service, and importantly, in the event of an emergency, how evacuation is achieved and the sizing of that. Considering the people, you then move on to how their journey works and the experiential nature of their journey. That then starts to drive us to think about how the routing works through the stations for ease of flow and efficiency of use, and then also to start considering the station environment, such as its materiality and how it appears to people as they're using it, and the facilities within the station. As you start to move through the station, you have to think about how the station integrates with the wider side of the urban realm. Stations are essentially a civic form of building now, and they have a big impact on the local area. We have to consider how they integrate with local development, how they integrate with onward moving services, and especially now how the environment is affected. That also brings into consideration elements of sustainability, so efficiency of materials, the amount of waste that's generated and how that's moved, and of course energy efficiency. All of that means that you start to drive a level of quality of aspiration about the design into the designers. And that therefore means that you have to make sure that you've got a design team that has the right set of skills, experience, and importantly, ambition.
London Underground's known for the simplicity and excellence of its wayfinding to enable customers to find their way around. How did you design that into creating a truly excellent customer experience for Elizabeth Line passengers?
Essentially, what we've managed to do is exploit the form of engineering construction. So, for example, in the tunnelled stations, we've utilised sinuous forms to ensure there's clear passenger flow. So what that means is, unlike most underground systems, and particularly the London Underground system, where you have tunnels joining, we don't have right-angled junctions where people meet. That means we get a much more flowing run through the stations, and that combined with decluttering means that the signage systems are far more obvious, the customer information systems are right where you need them and have high visibility, and then as you move on to the platforms, we have above every single platform edge screen door a digital information system giving you your departing information. The stations are designed to also support intuitive wayfinding. So, for example, here at Tottenham Court Road, we have coloured cladding at various points through the station, and that helps you orientate yourself and locate where you are in the station and as part of your route out. That works in combination with signage on the rear of the platform, which includes local information and Metro London maps, so that you're able to determine which end of the station you need to exit.
As an operator, I'm really pleased to see that we've incorporated platform screen doors into the design, just as we did on the JLE, the Jubilee Line extension, a few years back. So what are the benefits that platform screen doors bring, and why did you incorporate them into the Elizabeth Line?
Well, of course, one of the main differences between the Elizabeth Line and the Jubilee Line in how we've incorporated platform screen doors is that we have a full height system here. The Jubilee Line is only a half height system. Essentially, platform screen doors serve two functions. One is safety, and the other concerns the passenger environment. Considering the safety function, platform screen doors, of course, stop and prevent accidental falls onto the track from the platform. And in the event of an emergency on the running railway, where there might be some smoke generated, of course, it stops the smoke coming into the station. So two very important aspects of safety there. In terms of the passenger environment, because the platforms are separated from the trains, the platform environment is a much cleaner air environment. The screens also assist with the ventilation on the platform, so we have a cooler platform, so much more comfort. It also reduces the noise on the platform, so the PA system is much more intelligible. And with the system that we have designed here, it incorporates the platform lighting, digital customer information screens above every single door, so right at the point of use before you get on the train, and of course digital advertising. So overall, they introduced the benefit of safety and an improved customer environment with a one singular hard-working element.
Julian, these are clearly stations that have been designed not just for current customers, but for many generations of users to come. So how did you future-proof the design of the Elizabeth Line?
Elizabeth Line stations have already been designed with an uplift of 28% of opening day passenger figures in mind. That means all the spaces within the stations are already designed for additional people. And some of the stations also have been designed to accommodate additional escalators. Platforms are designed and built at 250 metres or thereabouts, and we start on opening day with a 9-car train, which is approximately 200 metres long. That means that we can expand the trains by 2 cars without having to rebuild platforms. In addition, the stations are all designed with 120 years design life. That means that all the fixtures, fittings and equipment has been designed to be very robust. And it's also designed on the basis of a plug and play or interchangeable arrangement, which enables very quick or quicker, I should say, replacement and maintenance.
So Julian, building new infrastructure doesn't just benefit London, it in fact benefits the whole of the UK. Can you tell us more about that?
Yes, I mean, probably the best way of illustrating this is to say that in excess of 90% of the contracts that were let for the construction of the Elizabeth Line went to companies that were UK-wide based. Of that 90%, in excess of 60% were to companies outside of London. And a way to illustrate that might be to look at, say, Tottenham Court Road Station. The glass panelling that we have comes from Glasgow. The signage systems manufactured in the Isle of Wight. And the GRC that we see throughout the station was all manufactured in Doncaster. So there's a lot of hard work that's gone into building the Elizabeth Line, and a lot of that has been spread throughout the United Kingdom. Now we've seen some of the features of the Elizabeth Line stations, what do you think the Elizabeth Line will mean for London?
Well, it's hard to know where to start, really. There's so many benefits that the Elizabeth Line will bring. For starters, it's accessible, not just in the central core, the 10 new stations, but also the stations on the east and the west that Network Rail have been renovating. It's temperature controlled. It's a clean, modern, safe environment that I know that Londoners will love. It adds much needed capacity, something like 10% of additional capacity to London's transport network. And finally, and maybe less tangibly, this is the ultimate symbol of London's emergence and resurgence from the COVID pandemic that we faced. Nothing could provide a greater lift to Londoners, and I'd say to the whole of the UK, than this stunning new railway, and I can't wait for it to open.